Hello, this is Eric, the Cocos Evangelist. In the last video, I introduced you to the scripting system and the logic of character movement. Today's content is about how to animate the character and how to upgrade the runway. If this video is helpful to you, please remember to subscribe. You may still remember that in the last video, when we ran the game, the camera angle was a little problematic. So we should first adjust the position of the camera. Click the main camera. You can see that the camera is pointed at the back of the character's head. So, we first drag the main camera node to the hero node, and reset the camera node, including its position and rotation, etc. Now the camera node and the hero node overlap completely. We can't see anything from the camera now, right? So we can adjust its z-axis so that it can face the right side of the character. Meanwhile, making the camera a child of the hero node also allows the camera to follow the movement of the character. As you bring the perspective closer, you'll find that the character looks quite dark, right? So we can give him a spotlight. Create, light, spotlight. Next, we still use the W, E, and R gizmos. Adjust the position of the spotlight. Let it point to the forehead of the character. Let's see the effect. Looks good. Let me drag the camera a bit to the right, to about this position. Next, time to animate the character. Open the animation panel. Select the Cocos node. You can see that it has an animation component and a clips property. Click clips, you'll find the character has 9 animation clips. Now enter the animation editing mode. It has animations like idle, attack, death, fall, and squat, etc. What we need is the jump animation. Let's see the effect. It has a complete jump and fall process. Just choose the jump animation. Double click to open the player controller script. We need to get the animation component of the character, then play the animation. Let's go back to a point we haven't discussed before about how to use the decorator property. Property determines how the property is presented on the editor and what it is serialized to. The parameters of property are as follows. The first one is type, which determines the data type of the property. We should declare all their types except number, string, and boolean, which can be left undeclared. We should declare the type of all arrays. Number, string, and boolean are declared as CC integer or CC float, CC string, and CC boolean. The next one is visible, which means whether the property should be displayed in the inspector panel or not. Properties are visible by default. You can leave it out if you have no special needs. Display name represents the name of the property to be displayed in the inspector panel. By default, the name displayed in the inspector panel is the name of the property, unless you want to redefine a name for it, otherwise you can just leave it. Tooltip represents whether the content defined by the tooltip is presented when the mouse is moved over the property in the inspector panel. Read-only means whether the property is read-only in the inspector panel. Min, max, step, and range are used to limit the range of values. Range supports setting an array. The first number in the array is min, the second one is max, and the third one is step. The last parameter is slide, which indicates whether to display a scroll bar in the inspector panel. After knowing the parameters of property, we can define an animation property and associate it with the animation of the Cocos model. Configure its property type, which is animation. The animation must come from CC. We can also see animation among the modules imported from CC. Okay, name it Cocos Anim. And its type is animation or now. Although its type is animation, because we haven't assigned a value to it at the beginning, it should also be of now type. So we declare it as animation or now type. The initial value is now. If you're sure that you'll assign a value to Cocos Anim in the editor, you can also remove the or now and put an exclamation point here. Why should we add an exclamation point here? That's because in the strict mode, it must be declared as animation or now type so that the value can be now. Otherwise, the value can't be now. But in fact, we will definitely assign a value to the Cocos Anim property in the editor. I like to write the code later without having to determine that the value might be now. In other words, I want to skip the checking in the strict mode, so I can just add the exclamation mark after now, which means it will definitely have a value. I will still obey the strict mode here. Save. Back to the editor. Select the hero node. You can see that it has a Cocos Anim property now, and it's of animation type. Then drag Cocos in here. Because the Cocos node has an animation component, if we drag the node in here, the editor will retrieve if there are components of the same type on the Cocos node and associate them to the property. Okay, next, write the logic of the animation. The animation is played after the mouse up event. So we should judge if the Cocos Anim exists. If it exists, just play the animation. To play the animation name is required as a parameter. Back to the editor to find the name of the animation. It's called Cocos Anim Jump. Let's go back to the editor. Run and take a look. Click the mouse. It's a loop mode, and it takes too much time to play the animation. We will shorten its playing time later. In other words, to increase the playback speed. We use this method, getState in the animation, to get the current clip state. There is a speed parameter in the state. Adjust it to 3.5 times. Take a look. It plays a lot faster. We haven't cancelled the loop mode, so it keeps playing. Take a look. Because its own actions are played in a loop, and also, after the jump is complete, it needs to go back to the standby state. We don't need to cancel the loop, just set it to the standby state. Remember, we have a piece of logic code here. When the jump is over, we can continue to receive the mouse up event. At the same position, replay the standby action. Also, add the judgment logic. Okay, return to the standby mode after jumping. You may think the moving time is too short, or this jumping animation is playing too fast. You can also adjust it yourself. For example, set the time a little longer and reduce the speed. Now it looks better. But I'll just keep my original parameters. You can just adjust them according to your needs. After playing the jump animation of the character, the next step is to upgrade the runway. This runway is of a specific length, and there may be some pits on the runway. If he falls into these pits, the game is over. Okay, with such a requirement, how should we build it? Because of the specific length, if I keep copying and pasting, and adjust them one by one, it will be a bit stupid, right? So we generate the runway by code. Remove the road first. Create an empty node, cloud. and generate a prefab of the cloud node. Name the new folder as prefab. Then drag the node cloud into the folder. It will become a prefab. The prefab is like a template. In other words, I packed a grid of rows into a template. Later, we will use code to instantiate this template. Instantiation is to apply the template in our actual scene. Okay, this cloud in the scene can be deleted because we need to instantiate the prefab by code. Then I create another script. This script is used to generate the runway named Game Manager. Also, generate an empty node in the scene named Game Manager. It's used to attach the game management component. Save the scene first, then open the Game Manager node. Now we can use this component to generate rows. First, we need to define a property. It's the prefab of the road, current prefab. Because I only need to declare its type, other parameters remain unchanged, so we don't need to declare its type in this way. We can declare its type by abbreviation. The editor can also recognize. After declaring this type, associate it with the property. In addition, we have to define the length of the runway we want to design. Define it as 50 units, which is 50 degrees. Next, start generating rows. At the time of initialization, I need a random number. As I said before, I want to generate rows with some pits at the same time. If the character falls into these pits, the game is over. So we need an array to store the row type. Then we define an enum value of the row type, block type. BTNone means this position is a pit. And BTStone means the road. The enum declaration value starts from 0 by default. That is, the value of BTNone is 0, the value of BTStone is 1. Then we add BTStone to the position 0 of the array, making sure that the character have something to stand on when he is generated. Then we use a loop to determine the type of each subsequent grid of the runway. In this loop, determine the type of the current road grid according to the previous one. If the previous road grid is a pit, then this grid must be a road. Then you can use a random number to determine the road type. The default range of the random number is from 0 to 1. Then we multiply the value of the random number by 2, extending the range to between 0 and 2. Next, we use rounding down. After being expanded, values between 0 and 1 are rounded down to 0, and which between 1 and 2 are rounded down to 1. Since the position 0 of the array has been filled, the filling should start from position 1. Then define a function which takes a parameter of type block type to generate rows according to the type. The final result returned may be a road or a pit. When the value is BTNone, it's a pit. So we judge whether it's a road based on the returned value. If it's a road, we add it under the game management node to be its child. Then set their positions. Next, let's run it. There are rows and pits, right? Looks alright. Okay, that's all for today. Today I mainly talked about how to control the character's jump and how to upgrade the runway. In the next video, I'll talk about the state control of the game. As you can see, the game is not over when the character falls into the pit, so we need to keep improving the code. See you in the next video, and please remember to subscribe.